Hey everyone! Today's video is about a subject that I think is very interesting. If I had to summarize it in one sentence, I would say that it's about the effect of gravity on the optical properties of space. Now, this may sound a bit cryptic, so let me try to explain. You've likely seen images made by the Hubble and James Webb telescope that show examples of so-called gravitational lensing. And in the images, the effect of the lensing is observed as these circular or sometimes wavy patterns. Gravitational lensing is observed close to celestial bodies that we know have a large mass, like for example galaxies. And what we observe in gravitational lensing is light originating from another object that is generally very far away. This light can, for example, not reach us directly because of absorption of the light by an object in between, like a large galaxy, but we can still observe it because it's bent around the intermediate object due to a strong gravitational field. And this allows part of the light to still reach us. So this light is not traveling in a straight line, and only light emitted at very specific angles by this faraway object will reach us. Light that passes the central object further away will bend less and will therefore miss Earth, and the same is true for the light that passes the object too close by. So, for this reason, the lensing often shows up as fairly narrow circular lines. Now, the intermediate object really works similar to a lens, but it's not like the type of lens that is, for example, in your camera. An equivalent glass lens would have kind of an odd shape, because it needs to bend light more in the center than at the edges, and this is in fact quite different from the way that a conventional confocal lens redirects light. Now, you're probably aware of this, but I need to mention it anyway. These schematics here are as incorrect as they come in terms of proportionality. The two galaxies displayed contain tens to even hundreds of billions of stars, and they are displayed together here in the same image with Earth, a very humble planet around a very humble star. On the scale of Earth, the galaxies are displayed at a distance that is smaller than the distance between Earth and the Moon. So this depiction is only very, very schematic. But the reason that I show it like this is that there is no way that I can display this with the right proportions in basically any schematic. So my hope is that in your imagination you can somehow put this image into a more correct perspective. The explanation for why light bends around a heavy object can be found in the theory of general relativity. In this theory, gravitation is described as the curvature of space-time around a massive object. It's generally visualized in plots like these, where this surface here is meant to illustrate how space is bent. And apparently, light also bends as a result of the curvature of space. Now, the theory of general relativity is quite a radical departure from Newtonian mechanics. In Newtonian mechanics, massive bodies attract each other due to some mysterious force that acts on them and is dependent on the mass and the distance between them. But according to general relativity, it's the mass of the body itself that curves the space around it, and any object in space that does not have other external forces acting on it just follows the total curvature based on momentum and the local gravitational field gradient. Now, personally, it took me quite some time to realize that these images do not really visualize the curvature of space itself, but rather something that is called the gravitational potential. And gravitational potential is very similar to electrostatic potential, or a voltage, something that many of you will know from physics classes. So let me take electrostatic potential as a starting point for my explanation. Say we have a couple of charged particles distributed in space. For this case, we will assume that they all have negative charge. And from this charge distribution in space, we can calculate the electrostatic potential for each point as follows. We take the contribution of each charge to the potential value in point P, which is equal to the amount of charge, divided by the distance to the particular charge times a constant, which is called the Coulomb constant. And it's this constant that relates the potential in volts to charge in coulombs and distance in meters. Since there are multiple charges, we can calculate the total potential in a point as the sum of the individual contributions, and this results in a total value for the electrostatic potential in that particular point. So that is what is indicated in this formula. The electrostatic potential in point P is the sum of the contributions to the potential by all charges present. Here's a slightly different representation of how that looks when we view it in 3D, and this is more in line with the graphs I showed you for the gravitational field. Now, for a gravitational field, we can define something very similar. We call this the gravitational potential. In the case of point masses, this gravitational potential is equal to the sum of the contributions by all masses divided by the respective distances and corrected for the gravitational constant instead of the Coulomb constant. And you can quickly see that if you get too close to a particular point mass, the contribution of that mass to the gravitational potential goes to strongly negative values because we're dividing by the distance. Luckily, true point masses are very rare in reality, but the fact remains that the value for the gravitational potential goes to strongly negative values pretty quickly. You might wonder why use negative values in this case. Well, that's a matter of definition. For convenience, we define the gravitational potential to be zero at an infinite distance to all mass. And since the potential energy of any object decreases near a mass, this automatically results in the gravitational potential having negative values near massive objects. Anyway, what you observe as a result of the presence of mass is a gradient in the gravitational potential. So if you look at why light would deflect in a gravitational field, it's not so much the value of the potential itself, but the derivative in the gravitational potential that causes the light to deflect. And when I realized this, immediately an analogy between gravitational potential and refractive index popped up in my mind. And that's the topic of this video. I will try to relate the refractive index of space to the gravitational potential. Now, you might not be familiar with the concept of refractive index, but I'm actually not going to discuss it here, mainly because there are already so many good videos about the subject. Which one to watch? Well, let's see what the YouTube Wheel of Recommendation suggests.
Ladies and gentlemen, place your bets now. Rien ne va plus.
You gotta be kidding me. Anyway, if you want to know about refractive index, maybe watch one of these two videos first and then rejoin us here in a bit. With this out of the way, we can just sit back and relax. Let's watch some simulations that show the effects of refractive index and how it affects the propagation of light. Here's a couple of blocks of transparent materials that have different refractive indices. Notice how the speed of the radiation seems to slow down due to the electronic interaction with the material. And it's clear that this effect is most prominent in the material with the highest refractive index. The following simulation is especially relevant for our current topic. It's a simulation of a so-called gradient index lens, which is basically a glass rod that contains a gradient in the refractive index. The highest value can be found in the center of the rod and the lowest value at the edge. In the simulation, we're looking at a cross-section of such a lens, and it shows how the radiation effectively slows down more towards the center of the rod, curving the wavefront and thereby focusing the light. So in this case, the material itself has become a lens. Now, refractive index, as we know it in physical materials like glass or water, does of course not directly apply to empty space. For one, because empty space does not contain the charged particles like electrons and ions that are required to effectively slow down electromagnetic radiation. So when referring to a refractive index of space, I'm assigning some hypothetical property to space that has the same net effect on the propagation of light. And to indicate that I'm talking about something that is fundamentally different from the standard refractive index, I will refer to this property as the gravitational index of refraction. Now, of course, it would be nice if we could simulate the effect of gravitational lensing using a simple refractive index. And to do this, a logical assumption would be that the refractive index of space is somehow proportional to the gravitational potential. However, the gravitational potential is either zero or negative, and the refractive index is generally positive and larger than one. So let's add some things. For example, a one as an offset value. Also, let's make sure that the gravitational index of refraction and the potential have an opposite sign. The constant added has a positive value and determines the proportionality between the two, and in the simulation, the value of the constant is a bit arbitrary. We'll just put in a value that gives us nice results in the simulation. Now, of course, I have no idea whether these two properties are truly in a linear relationship. Maybe at extreme values, the relationship breaks down and becomes non-linear, for example, in the order of the gravitational potential. But since I don't know, let's not worry about this too much. So let's assume that we have one point-like mass and that we can describe the resulting gravitational potential with this fairly simple formula for every point in the space around it. As mentioned earlier, one of the issues when working with point masses is that the value of R can go to zero, which would make the gravitational potential go to minus infinity, and the corresponding refractive index go to plus infinity. But we all know that using infinities in any calculation is generally a bad idea. So for the current simulations, we will assume that the refractive index tops off at some value, will smooth the top a bit, and will leave out any singularities. Okay, so let's go. Let me first replace these animations by something that is a bit less distractive. Better. On the left, I have placed a source that will in a moment start emitting incoherent radiation in all directions. In the middle is a concentrated large mass, which introduces a gradient in the refractive index of space. This gradient is effectively falling off with the inverse of the distance to the mass. And on the right, there is a detector for the emitted radiation. Just two remarks, we will ignore the mass of the emitter and the detector, and we need to accept as a limitation of the simulation that it can only handle 156 values or grayscales for the refractive index. And this will actually cause some artifacts, which I will point out to you when they arise. Anyway, enough talk, let's just start the simulation. Now pay special attention to what happens around the center object. We can observe that the light effectively slows down while it's getting closer to the heavy object. And because of the wave character of this radiation, the same deceleration also curves it around the object, thereby effectively changing the direction of the wavefront. In line with what we expect, radiation passing close by will bend significantly stronger and therefore miss the detector. Similarly, the radiation that is more to the outside will also not reach it, and only light with these specific directions will reach our detector. Okay, personally, I think this is a pretty cool simulation. Here's another one, where the source emits coherent radiation. The previous simulation displayed radiative intensity. This one shows the amplitude and phase of the coherent radiation, and this allows us to see the effect of refractive index on, for example, wavelength more clearly. The circles here are artifacts that are due to the limited number of available refractive index values in the simulation, so they're not significant, and the same is true for any diffraction patterns that we observe here. Now, I think the nice thing about these simulations is that you can at least superficially understand how gravitational lensing works from a wave perspective. The main question is, of course, do these simulations also make sense from a physics point of view? Well, let's take a closer look. In the simulations, we observe that light gradually slows down by the gradient in the refractive index of space. And at first glance, this seems to oppose both our general intuition and everything we have learned about the properties of light. We generally think of things accelerating when they enter a strong gravitational field rather than slowing down. But not only that, this slowing down also seems to contradict the fact that the speed of light, when measured empirically, always has the same value. The latter has been experimentally verified in a long row of experiments starting in 1887 with the efforts of Michelson and Morley. And every experiment done since confirms this. When you measure the speed of light in vacuum, whether you're stationary, moving at a high speed, or even when you are accelerating, your measurements will always return exactly the same value. The speed of light is not only what relates space to time within every frame of reference, it also relates mass to energy, and this makes it the most important constant in physics. So at first glance, the previous seems to be a good reason to say, okay, these simulations look nice, but they're not very realistic from the perspective of physics. But what now if we consider the effects of relativity in this scheme? Well, in that case, things actually turn out just fine. And the main reason is that we ourselves, as observers of this phenomenon, are actually not measuring the speed of light in this location. So let me explain. Say that we have found some brave volunteer that is willing to actually measure the speed of light for us near to the heavy object. Meet Samantha. Somehow we managed to get Samantha to this location. Now, if there were no external forces acting on her, she would start following the curvature of space and would start free falling towards the heavy object pretty quickly. But luckily, we put Samantha in a powerful rocket that keeps her stationary in space with respect to the distance to the heavy object. She does the experiment, measures the speed of light, and what do you know? She finds exactly the same value as everyone else. But how can that be if we are clearly observing light slowing down by a factor of 2? Well, simply because she and the rocket are being accelerated due to the forces exerted by the rocket engine. And this accelerating rocket is the frame inside which she does her experiment. The higher the gravitational field gradient, the stronger this external force exerted needs to be, and the higher the acceleration that she herself experiences. For her to measure the same speed of light locally would mean that her time frame is actually different from ours. It means that the atomic clocks used for the experiments in the spaceship run a lot slower. And this is one of the key things that follows from the theory of relativity. Within a frame of reference that is accelerating with respect to the curvature of space-time, time actually runs slower. Now, earlier in the video, I discussed how wrong the proportionality of this schematics is. And as a consequence of this, the proportions between objects and wavelengths are also completely off. Also, to get light to bend around an object like this, you need a fairly strong gradient in the refractive index. And the gravitational equivalent of this represents a value that is truly extreme. In fact, this simulation does not accurately represent how light would bend in the vicinity of a galaxy, but would be more consistent with the values you'd find in close proximity of a black hole. Just to illustrate how extreme these conditions are, a comparison. On the surface of Earth, you are also stationary with respect to a large mass close by, which is in this case the mass of Earth, and because of this, you experience an acceleration of 9.8 meters per second squared. Upwards, that is, because the force exerted on you is in the upward direction by the ground beneath your feet. Now, using this formula for the time dilation, we can calculate how much time is running slower because of this acceleration compared to the time for a faraway stationary observer. And when I plug in all the appropriate values, I arrive at a value of around 60 microseconds per day. And this is equivalent to the time slowing down by 7 times 10 to the minus 8%. And that's how much time runs slower on the surface of Earth due to an acceleration of 9.8 meters per second squared. Now imagine what kind of acceleration it would take not to slow down time by only 60 microseconds per day, but by half a second per second. I'm afraid that under these circumstances, Samantha would find operating the measurement equipment a bit of a challenge. Okay, I hope I was able to show that the concept of a gravitational index of refraction for space isn't as silly as it may sound at first. I'm far from an expert, but to me, representing the effects of gravity on light as a simple, intrinsic property of space is very appealing. And maybe, if we can accept that empty space is very much a material with properties analog to elasticity, inertia, energy content, and of course, refractive index, we can find an easy way to connect the macroscopic to the microscopic.